It's been a bit of a flashback for me these past 2 days to be in an academic community again. Since I left the university after my master's, I've been involved in many other types of organizations, in particular in civil society organizations that are active in the field of doing science with people together. Since about a couple of months, I started working for the Rathenau Institute, and I bring that experience into the field of our institute. And also in this talk, I'll try to touch upon a number of things that I've learned before joining the institute and that I now use in the work. It's about the intersection of openness and biotechnology. But first, maybe a little bit about the Rathenau Institute, because it's not a university group, it's not an academic institute. It's an institute that is funded by the Parliament of the Netherlands. And basically what we do is we research how technology will impact our society. And it started with Gerard Rathenau back in 1986. He was working for Philips, a big electronics company, and working on the personal computer at the time. And he recognized that this computer will have a huge impact on people's lives, and that something needed to happen. So for example, he introduced a policy through which people could buy a computer themselves to have one at home, partly subsidized by their employer. So people could take a computer from their work back to their home and then work on it together with their children and try to find out what it actually does. And since then the parliament said, well, but maybe we should have a permanent institute that looks for these new type of technologies that will change the way people work and the way people live. And we still do that today. So we look at the connection between science, technology, and society. But we also assess the impact of science itself. So it's also science system assessments. And we organize dialogue around these subjects as to, to bring the stakeholders together, use design thinking and other methods to connect stakeholders. And I'm now particularly interested in the field of open science. It's one area that we are just starting to explore. It's been mentioned already here at the conference in a few talks. A number of publications have been mentioned. And I'm particularly interested in focusing on this one, Open Innovation, Open Science and Open to the World by the European Commission. I think it triggered a lot of responses from other national governments to also respond to this. I think it's interesting to understand what the aims are of what has been portrayed here. For example, Carlos Moedas presented this in 2015, and he said that digitalization is basically driving this movement. Due to the internet and open collaboration methods, open science is the next logical step. When you read further on, he basically is describing that everybody could become a scientist through this this movement, and he's referring to the users becoming producers transition, and that's one that's very familiar to me, because when I was working in civil society organizations like the Waag Society, we build our own software, we build our own devices. Users becoming producers was a bit of the mantra by which we lived, but then of course now is the question: will users or the public also become scientists and produce knowledge themselves in a completely open and collaborative way? So at first when I started reading this, I was also getting enthusiastic, I must admit. And I was like, yes, all these open source projects that came forward out of this movement is amazing. Most of our mobile phones are running on Linux. All of these projects had a huge impact. But then if you start reading a little bit further, then you start noticing that Carlos Moedas actually is referring to platform technologies where people are becoming producers, but basically, of course, are also contributing to one of these companies. I think he's literally saying that if people can share a room in their house and use that as a means of production, maybe can also use a share of their brain and sell that or use that through the internet and work with that. So I think from my background of being part of this open science movement from a citizen point of view, I have a number of experiences and misconceptions that I countered into when I was reading this. And the first one is starts a bit with these definitions and the question, who is this public that we are talking about that wants to become a scientist? It's not so clear who exactly will start doing science themselves. And it starts already with the problem of the definition of open science. I don't know who of you already knows exactly what it means. Is there how many people are... Okay, there's a few hands going up, but most of them are still not going up. We also here, this conference has been talks about open access, open data. Let's say the left side of this picture, the academic impact of open science, but on the other side, at least I put it on the other side, are the elements of social responsiveness, open innovation, and sometimes responsible research and innovation is seen as part of open science, sometimes it's the other way around. That's not always clear. So that's where the first bit of the misconception starts. And well, to us, it's probably, if I now ask who knows what biotechnology is, and raise your hand, I think most of you should probably raise your hand. But to, of course, to the public, it's not so clear what biotechnology actually is. And it really depends on the context, on the type of biotechnology that you're talking about, whether people recognize that. And in Holland, every about 5 years, the National Committee on Genetic Engineering does a survey to see what people's perceptions are towards genetic modification in particular. And I think it's an interesting survey to look at to answer the question, will bioscience users actually become the producers of biotechnology? And this survey is set up in a quite a broad way. So they actually telephone people and also has an online survey. And they ask questions about the general use of media, general use of information, trust in institutes like the government or science. So it's quite of a broad questionnaire. And at some point, there are also questions about biotechnology, of course, and genetic engineering. And what's interesting to see is that about a third of the respondents, they are neutral to all the questions. They don't really have an opinion about what is being asked. And about 25% believes that the parliament and the government doesn't have enough knowledge about this subject to make a judgment. That's also an interesting finding. And when you look at different types of applications of genetic engineering, for example, the use of resistance genes in potatoes, or enzymes for detergents, or medicine that are being produced, the majority of the respondents are reluctant to whether it's been produced or genetic engineering is being used. They don't really care about that. So one of the first conclusions of the report is the public has no real interest in genetic modification. Also, they ask questions like come up with associations with different words, and then one of the words, of course, is genetic engineering or biotechnology. And then about 60% of the people answer with with associations like I don't know, I have no clue. So it's really it's a topic that's not very very well understood, or and also it shows that that a lot of people are not actively looking for information on genetic engineering. When they have asked that, then more than 60% says they never look for information of this subject and never attend any event that's about it. And I think it can be understood in many different ways, but I think John Dewey's theory about that people gather around issues rather than around topics in general is an important one to understand. Because one of the conclusions of the report is that there's still a huge mobilization potential among the public, because as soon as there's an issue that's coming up, maybe it's a risk to the environment or a position of a company in a business system, when there's an issue, people do care and they do have an opinion and they do are willing to organize themselves and take action. So that's where people can maybe be found to do something, to maybe conduct science themselves. This might be the public that is being referred to that can become knowledge producers in the open science framework. Then another misconception that you bump into a lot, at least in what I used to work in, is that science can provide all the answers. I used to run a open wet lab at the Waag, which is a space where people can come in and do science themselves. It was really, when we started, it was really an exploration. We wanted to know, is anybody actually interested? in doing biotechnology. We just provide the means in a small room in the center of the city. You can see the lab layout. It's some incubators, microscopes. We had a permit to do genetic engineering, so if someone wants to do that as well, it was possible. And we just said, okay, we have open evenings every week. You can come in and do biotech. A lot of people didn't understand is that they were expected to do it themselves. Often people came in and said, well, can you do this experiment for me? That was not the concept. The idea was that people would become science producers themselves, which is, of course, very daunting. I remember having conversations like someone coming in and saying, oh, I want to make electricity with plants. And at first, you know, as a former scientist, I would start asking, like, oh, what type of plant exactly? How much energy do you want to produce? And that most people were not really interested in that. They just want to make electricity with plants. And that was the very, very generic question. So then I said, okay, let's just start. And let's take any plant and then see where we end up. So yeah, this concept of that science is providing an answer directly is often not working for the public. And also openness doesn't always equal access or the ability to use science. That is maybe something that's obvious to you, but not to a lot of people. So what we try to do is make science more open and accessible and increase the ability for people to use it. So one way to do it is to make it more affordable and open source. So we developed a kit that you can build your own lab for less than 500 euros. So when you go to GitHub, you can download the designs, the parts lists, instructions on how to assemble it. You can make your own centrifuge, your own PCR machine, your own incubator, your own sterile hood, everything yourself, and assemble it. And then we also organized a course around it for people to follow for 10 weeks. And then we would explain exactly how to use it and what to make. And that did work quite well, at least in that amount of time, that fixed amount of time people would had a certain question, like how can I prolong my life? Man was already retired. He said, well, I would like to know more about life extension. Can I learn more about biotech? Maybe I can find a solution. So he followed this course and tried to use C. elegans worms, try to extend their lives. And also, yeah, in the process, of course, you find out that it's not so easy to do that. It's actually quite difficult. But at least, you know, people were creating this knowledge themselves. Another misconception that you sometimes bump into, once you find the people that actually want to do this and you give them the means to do it and some of the ability to do it, then these ROI principles that have been created for academia and industry, they don't really always work for prosumers. And I think to be able to understand that, you need to take a little bit of a step back. Users becoming producers. This process is of course driven by certain forces. Digitalization is one of them, of course, but also the technology is becoming more accessible. And at the Rathenau, we already made a report about it 2 years ago, and it was about how technology breeds and tames humans, and that we need more rules to that fit on this new paradigm. That it seems like these are two things that are not related that are discussed in this the report. It's about digital technology and about human germline editing. But if you look at it more closely, it seems to be more connected. That technology has a tendency to influence us, our behavior, and that's maybe also something that we should have rules for. What they refer to in the report is this notion of a cybernetic loop, that we use technology to sense, think, and act in our world. Sensing, for example, through sensors that we can put up in the world, facial recognition systems. You could say that social media is a way of sensing. We create the technology that thinks or that analyzes stuff. So we have big data, artificial intelligence, cloud computing. And also all kinds of technologies that can act in our world. So smart homes, self-driving cars, the drones. And all these things, they are connected and influencing our behavior. That's, let's say, the IT domain. That's familiar to a lot of people. But then you start applying this to biotechnology and thinking about people developing their own knowledge about biotech. Well, sensing, in theory, you could buy your own MinION and sequence your own genome. It should be possible right now, right? I think people sequencing human genomes on these devices. So that's a possibility. Then there's open knowledge available to look for SNPs that you might want to edit. It's getting more theoretical here, of course, but when you go to SNPedia, you think, like, I want to be a little bit more, gain a little bit in empathy, which markers are responsible for social behavior and personality. You can try and look for that. And then, yeah, there are also people that are doing do-it-yourself CRISPR injections, or this is an example of Aaron Trawick. He injected himself with a do-it-yourself herpes vaccine at a conference. That is already happening. And my concern, of course, is that the RRI principles and tools that have been developed to assess whether something is ethical or should be allowed doesn't really fit in this. It's not really tailored to this circle. So I think we have to learn and understand what is happening there and adjust the frame of thinking to this. And the fifth common misunderstanding I bump into a lot is that people believe that openness is free, that when knowledge is freely available, or that the tools are available, the space is there. Often it's believed that people just participate out of their own free will, but you all know that science is expensive. When we did, I was previously part of a project called Together Science, and we asked people a lot, okay, what do you think are things that should be improved also from a policy side to make the do-it-yourself science more possible? A lot of them answered that there's not enough funding, and that the funding mechanisms actually exclude non-academic scientists from the money. So if you really truly want to create an open science movement in which users become producers of knowledge, then also these funding mechanisms have to be adjusted to it. So those are my five points of learning. If you have any questions, please feel free to answer, to ask them. Yeah.
Thanks a lot for a very interesting talk. So, questions among the audience? Yes, there is one here at least.
Thank you. This is interesting thoughts. I was just wondering how that links to existing legal frameworks, for example, with GMOs. Right. I mean, there's a number of regulations where even researchers cannot do certain things just in a legal framework. This is nothing about RRI. This is real legal stuff, right? So if you just make the methods open, what is there any thoughts on how this would be controlled or how to communicate that? Or, I mean, obviously in other fields I cannot just make weapons of mass destruction in my cellar, right? So what about GMOs?
Yeah, well, that's a very important question that you raise. Also a concern. That's also why I said it's a bit of a blind spot at the moment in a lot of policies, that these tools are becoming available to people. And actually, it's one of the aims of the policy to turn consumers into producers of the knowledge. So the effect of that, of course, is that people start doing this themselves outside of the regulatory frameworks. Often they are not even aware that there are regulations, that you can buy these CRISPR kits now online, and you can do it in your kitchen, and then when you ask people, are you aware that there are actually regulations and licenses needed to do this? Most of them, are not aware of this. So, it's a good question. And maybe also as a scientist, you have a role in that, whereas at least as a scientific community, to educate people a bit about this. But also, I think from policymakers and other players in the whole ecosystem, have to be aware of this.
More questions? I have just one comment on this, on your opinion with respect to open access again, publishing in open access, which is kind of the trend now. Do you think it will lead to that there will be an increased public interest because of this, or will it be easier just for the same academia to have access to the scientific literature that is produced?
I think I think mostly it's for the academic peers interesting. It was also from the surveys you see that most people are only passively taking up knowledge about this subject. They're not searching for it themselves that much. Only a small group of the population.
But argumentation is beyond that, isn't it? Why we want open access?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So but you need an extra step of translation to do that. Yeah.
So you need journalists maybe to translate into more readable.
Yeah, for example.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, once again, thank you very much for your presentation. And